Well, it's interesting because that band was the first band that ever made me realize, like, holy cow, you could distort the bass and make it sound like a guitar, but also like a whole different instrument kind of thing.
It's crazy, and I mean, like, it's like, I'm a total geek at heart, like, music guy, as far as like equipment and just doing stuff, and like, as far as bass now, it's like so crazy how far it's come, and it's not just like what it used to be. And these guys, there's guys out there, there's like a band right now, it's these two young guys, and they do stuff on bass, it's just mind blowing. But anyways, so John, yeah, hit me up about that, and we started doing that, and that was fun. We did it for a while, played a bunch of shows. We actually went to Arizona a couple times. It was always hit with, like, some people either loved it or they absolutely hated it. You know what I mean? That's just, there was no in between, you know what I mean? And it was cool because we had support. I remember, like, Drew coming down and John Scott coming down to see us at times, like, you know, and just to come to see us, you know what I mean? It was cool that people, like, kind of picked up on it. Actually, we got asked to be on a compilation out of New York from, what's his name? Sam McFeeters was doing a label at the time called, I want to say, Firmaform. Anyways, we were doing a compilation, like the Man is a Bastard guys and stuff, and he had hit us up if we wanted to be on it. It never came through, but he was interested enough and liked about it and heard about it, so it was cool. And we did a demo, and it was fun. It just kind of stopped going. I don't know exactly why. I don't remember why. I think at that time, I also started doing a band with Mario from 411 and Click Attack, Ikatawi, right before he did Click Attack, out of the Vista, and I would drive down there and do that. So as Freebass fell apart, I was doing that with Mario, and we played for about a year and a half. It was cool. We played a handful of shows, but then he started doing a thing with the guys from Heroin, which turned into Click Attack, and that just got him really busy where it stopped. It was cool because it was that band was more like a post-hardcore band. It was like a band called Slint. Barry, I don't know if you've ever heard of them. Yeah.
So was that band Ashes Dust?
Yeah, it was called Ashes Dust.
Yeah, because we played together.
We did, didn't we?
We played at Cheap Guys, which is the Voodoo Glow Skulls record place.
Yes, I remember. That's I think one of the two shows that maybe we played. We were supposed to play the next day in San Diego, and something happened with one of the members. We couldn't play. I don't remember what happened, but. Yeah, and I remember that was like our big, because everyone had heard of us up here because we were from down there, but we never played up here. And then that was our first, like, okay, we're going to play up here. And, you know, I don't remember how the response was, but I remember feeling really good doing it. And I loved playing because we played in San Diego, but we never really played in Orange County. So
much about Freebase to me, like, looking back, and even then, like, you guys were ahead of your time just doing this sort of industrial type thing. That was, like, very big sounding. And, I mean, you know, you guys would play shows and play, what, 8-10 songs with a programmed drum machine. And it was pretty amazing. So I guess my question is, so you mentioned that you didn't know why things kind of fell off and broke up, but was there ever a plan to maybe go beyond the demo and do, like, a 12-inch or something? Was that...
You know, we just... I don't know if we ever really, I mean, I think we were, oh yeah. So we were going to do, I think, a 7-inch, and it was going to be on Workshed. But then I think Dan decided to do the next project, which was Mission Impossible.
Gotcha.
So Mission Impossible came out, and then he was focusing on that, and then we were supposed to come out too. But then everything kind of fell apart with us, and it just never kind of happened. But yeah, it was, I mean, ahead of its time, I don't know. I mean, I think it was just, you know, it was something that, I think it was a great something that happened. There were other bands that we played with a lot that were outside of the hardcore realm. One band is called Babyland, which are actually around. They're like a big industrial band, that are still around crazy. I saw them recently, like on a YouTube video. But we would play with them, and they was weird. They would find these like warehouses and they put shows on, and they had like big oil drums and saws and computers, and like everything was sequenced and programmed. And so we would do that too. And then we play, you know, hardcore shows. So we'd kind of bounce back and forth and have like different people and different genres and whatever.
Was that the easiest band you'd say you ever did? Cause it's just you and John and the drum machine.
Yeah. Yeah, it was really simple and really easy because, you know, we've been friends for so long. And, you know, as a band, you know, you have so many different personalities in it, and sometimes it clicks and sometimes it doesn't. And with John, it was just simple. Like when we go to Arizona, we would just, you know, we'd get a little minivan, put all our gear in it, and we're gone. Like, it was super simple. There was no, you know, just the two of us, and it was good.
How did...
Like, Ashes...
No,
like, in Ashes Dust. In Ashes Dust, we had three guitar players.
Yep.
Myself, and then, you know, so that was a bigger band and a lot more personalities. And I think part of why it didn't stick together was some of the personalities in it. Not that we ever fought or anything, but I think just different people have different visions and on what it was supposed to be, you know? And so I was always just kind of along for the ride, happy to be in it, you know, but yeah.
How did Chicano Christ happen?
So that was, I to be honest, would say I had nothing to do with it other than they hit me up and they're like, hey dude, you got to play bass. And I was like, yeah, okay, I'll do it. Like, and so I guess Mario was coming up and staying at the Fat House regularly for 411 practice. And then him and Juan became really good friends. And obviously Kevin was there. And the story that I had heard was they were sitting around joking about it would be funny if Econo Christ, it's the Econo Christ twist on it with the Chicano Christ. And they're all like, you know, Cholo guys. And we just write these really fast songs. So they wrote all the music and they called me. They're like, we got a bunch of songs. Come down and practice. I think we practiced like once, maybe twice. And then went in the studio and recorded everything. And I was like, I still was like, once we got to the studio, I remember going and got, do I know these songs? Like, you know what I mean? But we nailed them really quick. It was fun. And then we played one show in Irvine. And it was supposed to be us and Rage Against the Machine. And then the cops broke it up after our set.
Yes.
So then Rage never got to play. Yeah. But it was hilarious. It was fun. I mean, it wasn't supposed to be like anything other than what it was. And it was just fun, a bunch of friends playing together. And we switched instruments. I think Ron played bass on some songs. And I think Mario played guitar and drums. So, like, you'd switch with Kevin. So yeah.
You guys would purposely, as I remember, tune your guitars terribly. Like, I remember, like, Mario just, like, start before you guys started playing. Just, and I'm like, what is he doing? And then you guys. Yeah.
That show was crazy because it was in someone's garage and it was so packed.
Yep.
And I remember it just being nuts. And yeah, it was the only time we ever played, but it was fun. And it was cool just being, you know, it was nothing that was like a real band and we were friends and just having fun. And that was, you know.
And didn't that show, you guys playing, you guys kind of just showed up? Because I remember I came up to that show because I came up because I was like, oh, Mission Impossible and Rage are playing. And then I walked up. And then you guys are out front and you came up and you're all, yeah, man, Chicano Christ, we're playing.
Yeah, I don't remember how we got on that or if we just showed up. I just remember getting the call and like, dude, you got to be in Irvine. We're playing tonight. And I was like, okay, cool. Like, you know what I mean? We showed up. Unfortunately, we got to play. So whoever was there and actually got to see that, that was funny. Yeah. I always look to see if there's any footage of that anywhere, but I've never seen it.
See, that's the thing. I shot that show, and I have no idea where that tape is, where any of that is. You bring up a good.
I'd be hilarious to see.
Now you brought up Ashes Dust. How did you get in that again? Did you mention how that kind of happened?
So the Freebase thing kind of was falling apart, and then 411 had ended. And I think that's what happened. They got back tour or whatever and kind of just went their own ways. Then Mario was living in Vista. And just a random phone call one day, Mario called me. He's like, hey, listen, we just got rid of our bass player. And I don't know if you'd be into it. But it was obviously before the internet. He's like, I'm going to mail you a tape and listen to it. And if you like it, we'd really like you to play bass. So obviously like a week and a half later, I get the tape. I listened to it. It was awesome. And I was like, it's so different than, it was heavy, but really melodic and a lot of like really, you know, bring it down to like where it's clean and then bring it back up kind of stuff. And I was really into it. So I learned the songs and then I was going to come down for practice. And the couple days before he goes, oh, by the way, we just got rid of our singer too. I was like, oh, okay. All right. He's like, but I got a guy in mind. It's going to be perfect. And I was like, all right. So I came down and when I got down there, the singer, the new guy that was going to, you know, come in was there too. And he had happened to be friends with Mario for a long time and had been in bands with him when he was a kid, like really, really young. His name was, I think, Mark Hossetter. He was like a skater guy. So, yeah, he called me. We practiced once, and that was it. And then we did that for like a year and a half. I'd drive down to Vista like 3 times a week, and we would practice. And we played, like I said, in San Diego and stuff, and it was cool. We recorded a couple times. We did a couple different compilations, and then wanted to do – I think we wanted to release something, but like I said, it just ended up falling apart. Just, you know, conflicting personalities. And like I said, the next band that Mario did was Click Attack, and that was huge. I was a great band, and, you know, it took up all his time, so.
I wish I would have known the whole putting something out situation, because I was just starting Ringside Records at that point. And, like, I would have done it, because I remember when Mario did Click Attack, I remember talking to someone and being like, wow, I wonder if they would maybe want to do a 7-inch. But, I mean, they were on, like, another level, and I was like, yeah, there was nowhere.
At that time, that San Diego scene and stuff, then those bands that were coming out of there were, like, amazing. And he's just an incredible drummer anyway, so, yeah.
Yeah, it's like, he's one of those guys. Well, see, you brought up something that I wanted to ask you about. So you're totally self-taught at the bass, right? Like, but... you play, it seems to me, fairly intricately and fairly intricate stuff. And I remember Ashes Dust wasn't three chord punk or whatever. I mean, Ashes Dust was musicians. And so my question is, you get a tape like that in the mail, how do you like is there any nervousness? Like, how am I going to figure this out? Like, did you have to meet with the guys beforehand? Can you play it all by ear? Like, what's your process for something like that?
There isn't. I honestly, like, it was just more about, and to this day, I'm the same way. Like, am I playing this right? Or, you know, I've never really, like, my daughter plays double, like, the stand-up bass, the double bass, and guitar, and can read sheet music, like, sight music, and read it, and be like, I can't do that. Like, you know, I can hear it and figure it out, and sometimes it takes me a while, and, you know, but and that was what it was. And a lot of times, like, with them, which was cool, is we would just jam it out, and we would just jam, and to the point that we would honestly sometimes practice in the dark. And we built a studio at Mark's house, and we shut all the lights off. And had, like, 6-minute songs, and we would just play them, like in the dark. And it was just weird, but it was cool. The chemistry was good. Like when we would play and jam, it was great. It was just, unfortunately, sometimes, like I said, the personality sometimes weren't 100%, and that's kind of makes it not fun, you know?
Right.
But, as far as the Freebase stuff, Dean, like, you know, this is how I kind of wanted to go, and then after that, it's more just kind of figuring out what goes and doesn't go. Like, even to this day, like, I hear it, like, when I'm writing stuff or doing music now, it's like, well, that doesn't sound right. And maybe it doesn't technically go together, but if it sounds good to me, then I'll just kind of go with it.